Well, let's jump into Ecclesiastes 10 here in a moment. And let's pray together. Lord, here we are with the book open and your word set before us, and our hearts are desirous to hear from you. I thank you for men, for persons like Bob Smart and Karen and their children, and how you showed me yourself through them over all these years. And each of us gives you thanks for the people you brought into our lives. And we thank you for these words here now about leading. And we ask that you'd show us wisdom in leading. And ultimately, we know that shows us you. In Jesus, it's in your name. Amen. So if you look at chapter 10, verse 5, you see that he's going to start talking about leadership, you know, rulers, and the folly, the mistakes that leaders make in verse 5. There is an evil that I've seen under the sun, as it were, an error proceeding from the ruler. So, you know, he's walked through these various oppressions. He's naming the various difficulties of life under the sun. You know, life in church can be difficult. Life with money can be difficult. Even institutions that's supposed to bring us justice can misuse power. Now here he is saying, rulers, people who lead us, can make mistakes. They can be in error. And so what he's going to do here is unfold several of those kinds of errors that rulers make. And he does it with several proverbs. And as you read through the Proverbs, you get a sense of these errors. And so the first is verse 6, folly is set in many high places, and the rich sit in a low place. I've seen slaves on horses and princes walking on the ground like slaves. Again, that word slave there has a different connotation than the one many of us might have for it. It's still this idea that a person that's a person that would have ridden on a horse is walking. A person that would have walked is on a horse. He's using that to show the inversion that happens. And here he is in verse 8. He who digs a pit will fall into it, and a serpent will bite him who breaks through a wall. He who quarries stones is hurt by them, and he who splits logs is endangered by them. If the iron is blunt and one does not sharpen the edge, he must use more strength, but wisdom helps one succeed. So these first few proverbs is basically saying one error of a ruler is that he thinks he's not like other people. He thinks he's something other or more than human. And so even a ruler who digs a pit can fall into it. Even a ruler who sticks his hand where a serpent is can get bit. Even a ruler who quarries stones can get hurt by them, and splits logs can be endangered. I remember out in the back of the previous house where we lived, and there's a little bit of acreage there, land. It was a Saturday night. I was in the yard, sweeping up, and I'm praying and meditating on the sermon for the next morning and praying for the people there. And I lift up, you know, sort of a cardboard box. There's a big snake curled up right there, you know. And now we don't have very many venomous snakes in Missouri where I live. There are a handful, but this one looked scary, but it's not. But it looks, at the first moment, you know, you're trying to determine what kind of snake am I dealing with, you know. And, that shouldn't happen. I was praying, you know. I'm preparing for a sermon. I shouldn't have to encounter a snake. I'm a pastor doing God's work, you know. So you get the idea? These first three proverbs remind even the ruler in the context of his errors. The ruler can get hurt, you know. So we shouldn't think that because we're rulers, because we're in a, we're not kings, but those of us in leadership who have authority We shouldn't think that because we have that authority, we can do anything we want. And somehow we have immunity and a special favor from God. And we can do things that other people couldn't do. If other people did these things, sure, they might fall, they might be hurt. But, you know, we're rulers. And so we can do what others can't. Well, that's folly. Yeah, that's folly. Second thing he says here is, if the serpent bites before it is charmed, there's no advantage to the charmer. So you think about that picture, right? The serpent, the cobra is coiled up, and the charmer is doing all the playing on its flute and doing all his, you know, moves, and the snake is coming out. And this is really a humorous proverb because it's the picture of the guy doing all of his things, and the snake just bites him anyway. Like, you know, he comes out and he's doing his stuff, and the snake's there, and the snake just boom. And, you know, if a snake, there's no advantage to doing all of your charming if the snake's just going to bite you anyway. And it's a humorous proverb. It makes me think about a scene from a movie. It's an Indiana Jones movie. Yeah, where the ninja guy's, wah, and he's doing all this stuff, and so Indiana Jones just pulls out his gun and shoots him, which sounds kind of violent, but it's a humorous moment, you know. And so a ruler can be like that. It's sort of like that little parabolic story we heard from the wise man about the king, you know, with all of his great siege works taking on the little city, you know. Sometimes a ruler puts on all this show, you know. All of his act is charming and everything. And he can be bit just like anybody else. And if he gets bit before he does all that, what was the point of all that? So it's, what's the point of all the show? If you get bit just like anybody else. And then he begins to talk about the words of a ruler. Verse 12, the words of a wise man's mouth win him favor, but the lips of a fool consume him. The beginning of the words of his mouth is foolishness, and the end of his talk is evil madness. A fool multiplies words, though no man knows what is to be, and who can tell him what will be after him? Right there, this is a repeated theme, right, from chapter 5, that the fool multiplies words. But notice the particular kind. Remember in chapter 5, we talked about there's much dreaming. With many words and many dreams, there's folly, right, in church. And here he is saying, though no man knows what is to be, and who can tell him what will be after him? So this is the ruler who's always talking about a grand future. Always talking as if he knows. You know, this is tricky. Because as leaders, we don't want people to be afraid. We want to speak confidence. But it's folly to speak in such a way that we act as if we know what's to come when we don't. Yeah.
It's interesting about the New Testament where it says, you know, don't say, I'm going to do this and this.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
But if the Lord wills, it's that recognition that ultimately God's in control.
That's right. And so the first error is to think that we're not human, we're not like anybody else, we won't get hurt or burned by the things that hurt or burn other people. The second one is to be showy, to rely on our charming, you know, our ability to charm something when we can get bit like anybody else. And if we get bit, what was the point of all that? Now the third one is our use of words. The first is to trust our words, to multiply words, to think that our words are saviors, that our words are what really people need ultimately. If we just get the words right, then everything will be okay. That's a mistake. You and I know that. If you're sitting with a couple in a marriage, you know, problems, and you walk down through the Apostles' Creed, you're all going to agree with the words. Yeah, agree with those words. They're united in those words, but they're divided with each other. And We work very hard in our arguments with one another to, if I just get the words right, then she'll see. If I just got the words right, then he'll see. And sometimes it's not a matter of getting all the words right. There's a timing for everything. And so a ruler that trusts his words forgets that Jesus is the Savior and thinks that our words are. But the second part of that is talking in such a way as we propose to know the future. But even a ruler has to humble him or herself to acknowledge we don't know the future. And in verse 15, the toil of a fool wearies him, for he does not know the way to the city. This is another humorous one too. This is a ruler who governs a city but doesn't know the street names. He wearies himself trying to find his way around. But he doesn't know the way. And so the other way of wearying himself, one, he hasn't paid attention enough to know the roads in his own city that he rules, so that he would know the way through his own city. Why? I don't know. He's busy with other things. This is the city he's supposed to govern. He's using his time in such a way he doesn't know his way through it. The other way of wearying us, we touched on earlier. I'm going to, in verse 10, now come back to it and see it again. Doesn't take the time to sharpen his tools. If the iron is blunt and one does not sharpen the edge, he must use more strength. So it feels like a waste of time to sharpen the blade. I don't have time to sharpen the blade of the mower. I got to get out there and mow the grass. Yeah, but if you keep mowing the grass, you don't take time to sharpen it, then the blade gets dull. Gradually, you're going to have to do more work. And so this is the error of the ruler. I cannot take the time to rest and do the mundane for the long haul. There's no time for that. That's an error in the ruler. And then it's an error for the ruler to not know the way of this, not know his city that he governs, not to have taken the time to know the city that he governs is folly. So just a few more here, and then we'll pause and just reflect on it. Verse 16, woe to you, O land, when your king is a child and your princes feast in the morning. Happy are you, O land, when your king is the son of the nobility and your princes feast at the proper time for strength and not for drunkenness. So this is people in power misusing it. Through sloth, the roof sinks in, and through indolence, the house leaks. Bread is made for laughter. Wine gladdens life. Money answers everything. Even in your thoughts, not curse the king, nor in your bedroom, curse the rich. For a bird of the air will carry your voice, and some winged creature will tell the matter. So in short here, verses 16 through 18 is talking about people in power who misuse the resources. So they're supposed to use the daytime to be of strength for the people they serve. But instead, the fool uses the resources to get drunk. That is, they use it for their own pleasure. And the people, therefore, are left to be hurt. The roof should have been taken care of for the people to have a shelter. But the princes are out using resources for other things. So the roofs that the people need go unfixed. And it's happy for a land when the ruler foregoes drink during the day, even though he could drink because he's a ruler. But he foregoes it and instead uses his strength. The princes uses their strength for the sake of the people that they govern. There's a time to have a drink. And when work needs to be done, that is not the time. And then there's this general proverb about bread is meant for laughter. Isn't that something? wine gladdens life. This is a strange assumption for us, but not for Ecclesiastes, right? He's been saying this all along. Bread and wine are made for our enjoyment. There's nothing better, right? This is part of the gifts that God has given us. That phrase, money answers everything, is trouble for us because it's a proverb. We want to say, wait a minute, money. We want to pick on the word everything. Money doesn't answer everything. We already know that he knows that, right? There at the end of chapter 5, he just went through this litany of the misuse of money. So he's not saying that money is the answer for everything in the sense that it's what satisfies us. He's already displayed the misuse of money. But money does matter. It's a practical statement. Bread, wine, money. People need food, drink, and an economy, right? And when a ruler misuses the funds and resources and strength for his own gain, the food, the drink, and the economy that was meant to bless the people don't bless them. It's wrecked. So then it's a little bit strange because then he shifts to a proverb that doesn't have to do with the ruler. It has to do with the servants of the ruler. I'm not sure why. But even in your thoughts, do not curse the king. So here you have this proverbs of the errors of a king, the evils of a ruler. Thinks he's not like other people and doesn't have to surrender to what they do. Thinks it's a waste of time to do mundane things like sharpening a blade or getting to know the street names of the city that he governs. He misuses resources so that the people's roofs are left leaking and their economy suffers. Even still, right? Don't curse the king. Why? Because a guy that's misusing power like this will hurt you. In your bedroom, don't curse it, for a bird of the air might carry your voice and some winged creature tell the matter. This is poetry, right? He doesn't believe that birds can speak, right? Like he's using the poetry of you think you're speaking in quiet and no one can hear you, but someone's listening and they take that word off and tell the king, you know? So it's a practical statement when you're in the context of the evil of a ruler like this. You have to watch your words. So that's very quick. But what are you making of this? We're not kings, but we all have various roles of leadership at home or in the church or both.
Question in verse 6. Where it says, folly is set in many high places, and the rich set in a low place. I find this interesting because he's contrasting instead of folly and wisdom.
Yes.
He's contrasting folly and rich. And I was just wondering whether, in a sense, the rich is being viewed in the same light, well, rich and wisdom are being completely combined together. You know, in the same sense that disciples say, if a rich man can't get in, no one can. That right. sense that the rich have it all together.
Right.
Yeah. Is that what's happening?
Yes, I think so. I'm looking up here just to remind myself because that's a good question and my mind's fuzzy on it. But that makes sense to me.
It just seems odd because you would think it would say follier and it's an evil that the follier in high places and the wiser in low places. That would seem to make.
Yeah, it's the one time in this book. That's why it's jogging my. It's the one time in this book where it seems like he's flipped always before wise, young, and poor go together, folly, rich, and king go together, and so this one's. This is the one place in the book where it seems to be at odds. Oh, okay. Sometimes the wisdom literature puts the rich into a negative light. For example, Proverbs 28:6, better is a poor man who walks in his integrity than a rich man who is crooked in his ways. That's what we've seen so far in this book. But at other times, the wisdom literature uses the term rich to identify the faithful, fair, patient, and hardworking character of a person. So example, Proverbs 10:4, a slack hand causes poverty, but the hand of the diligent makes rich. A faithful man, this is Proverbs 28:20, a faithful man will abound with blessings, but whoever hastens to be rich will not go unpunished. Notice that the preacher does not contrast the rich in a low place with the poor, but instead with folly in many high places. So up to this point, he's contrasted rich with the poor. But in this case, he's contrasting rich with folly. Rich in a low place, folly in many high places. The preacher uses the word rich here not to identify material possessions, but to identify true, steady, and faithful character of a person from which a measure of wealth generally comes. So rich does not refer to the lottery winner or to the heir or to the thief.
So you could say this rich person is the wise, faithful man.
Yes.
Who out of his wisdom and faithfulness has ended up rich.
Yes, yes. That's right. And so in that light.
Yeah, that makes sense.
It shouldn't be the way it is. Yeah, I remember the first time I saw that, I thought, wow, this is the first, you know, this is a little tricky here. But looking at the rest of how the wisdom literature sometimes uses rich, that's what, oh, and then it shows, oh, he's comparing rich with folly here, which is different than rich and poor, which the way he's done that the rest of the book. So it seems to, anyway, that seems to be what it is. So rich here refers to the one who worked long and hard, and from such work and faithfulness wealth came. The preacher's point is that an erring leader overlooks this kind of faithful character and places impatient, wandering, slothful, get-rich-quick schemers tragically in charge. So it's promoting the wrong people in verses 6 and 7 there. An error, you know, flowing from the ruler. And similarly, slave in this analogy is contrasted not with workers or freed persons, but with princes. The preacher follows a sage tradition, so Proverbs 19:10. It's not fitting for a fool to live in luxury, much less for a slave to rule over princes. The preacher doesn't refer here, you know, like to slaves in America or other kinds of places. The slave here refers to a criminal or a debtor or a prisoner of war. So 1 Kings 9:15, Solomon utilizes captives for work. So his poetry in this proverb state the general truth. It's normatively unwise to put criminals serving their sentences, or debtors who cannot manage themselves, or prisoners of war from a foreign land into positions of authority and care over others. We remind ourselves that a preacher's choice to use a proverb instead of prose makes this, you know, matters. A proverb states something that's normative but not final. So, for example, Joseph, after all, rises from slavery to lead Egypt. The preacher's not, you know, stating an exhaustive truth. He's stating a normative guide that it's generally unwise and unhelpful when our politicians, rulers, kings have been or are crooks. And so that's how he's using the word rich and slave. But yeah, it throws us off at first, which I think is helpful that it throws us off, because if you read through the book, you go, oh, this is different than the way he's used these words. The fact that it's different causes us to search it out, and we realize, oh, he's using it differently. Yeah.
Verse 10 is interesting. It kind of goes with the proverb about to say that a rich man answers harshly, mm-hmm. but you know, a poor man has to speak persuasively. So, you know, if you've got power, you can sort of talk down to people. If you don't sharpen, you take that, make the effort to, you don't have to make the effort to keep your axe. You're going to have to use more force, but if you've got lots of power, it doesn't matter. But eventually, you know, the system might not be charmed. Yeah. And so your you know, revolutions and things that happen,
yeah,
like Rehoboam, like he sort of answered partially and the people just up and didn't take it, you know?
Yeah.
So, yeah, there's a time comes when, you know, foolishness doesn't work anymore.
Yeah. It works for a while.
Well, you often see that with people, you know, before they're elected. They talk yeah. quite differently than even after they're in power.
Yeah.
Quite noticeable change.
You know, that's a real, and I think that's a real important point for us. You know, the Westminster Confession of Faith reminds us when it talks about sacraments that the efficacy of the sacrament is not tied to the minister who serves it, right? But to God, you know. And someone can be in power here and get their way, and things can even be working for them, and therefore they think that they're wise, that they're... And there's a similar analogy for us in ministry leadership. We can think that we don't have to sharpen our blade. I mean, after all, look around. People are blessed by my preaching, or they're this or that, or they're ministered to by my counseling, or this or that, and everything must be all right. I must be good. And we forget that God, our Lord, blesses the means of His grace like the ministry of His word, not because of you and me and our righteousness, but because of His faithfulness to feed His people. And so if I'm saying something true to His word, His Spirit will take it up and bless His people. That doesn't mean that I must be, you know, okay. And I've seen this among younger men, myself included. The Lord blesses their preaching, blesses their Bible study. People come to hear them. So they begin to think to themselves that somehow they don't have to be like other people. And so their tempers get the best of them. But hey, God's blessing my ministry. Or they're starting to flirt a little bit, a little too familiar with the women around, or they're just tired and burned out, but they won't rest, you know, or they just begin to think, but look at all the things God's doing. As if because God's working, I don't have to then act like a finite creature. You know, it's an error. If you dig a pit, you can fall into it. And that's true even if 1,000 people are telling me I'm the best preacher they've ever heard. I can still get bit by a snake. I still have to sharpen my blade. You know, what good is all my charm if I'm going to get bit in the end? You know, yeah.
Quite interesting that that Solomon balanced, well, it's not interesting, it's not surprising, but Solomon balances himself so well here. You know, he says, sharpen yourself, equip yourself. So I think in the life of the pastor, you know, keep studying, work in your office and train yourself. But then he says, on the other hand, use your resources for people. If you sit in your office all day long training yourself, but never actually go out and pastor the people, it's for nothing.
Yeah.
And just fun. He balances it so well. He sort of really emphasizes this, but then reminds us of the other one.
Yeah. Yeah, you could. There's a similarity there for us in pastoral roles of leadership. If our strength isn't used for the, you know, good of the people, and of course that's very clear in Ezekiel, The prophet Ezekiel makes that clear, maybe chapter 33 or 34, somewhere right in there where he lists the shepherds, you know, how they've used, the shepherds of Israel have used the resources for them, for themselves, and that his people, like sheep, you know, the lame haven't been mended and the lost haven't been searched for and things like this. And so that he says this marvelous thing, you know, so I will send a shepherd after my own heart, you know, I will be their shepherd. And but it's still that idea.
Did you get Islam in Corinthian, you know, 13 about love? They do all this other thing. We don't have love. You know, like you do all the good work. And you, you know, we're up there. And then we don't have love. It's like you see, we do all our charm, but no. You know, get bitten. You know, it's contrast of have a Lord.
That's right. What is this? Just meditate on the Lord Jesus for a moment as our ruler, as our King. Just think about him for a moment. As you read down through these errors, you're seeing these are not errors the Lord made.
He faced the same dangers that we do. I mean, he, by being incarnated, he also was liable to snake bites.
We have to assume, don't we, that the when the Lord was six, he fell and scraped his knee. You know, or when he's working in a carpenter shop, he I mean, you know, I'm not a guy that works with my hands every day, but my friend Mark is, and he's always got a bruise on his finger or cuts on his hand or, you know, a little dirt in there under the nail, you know, from the work of the day. So our Lord would have had that as a carpenter. Face the same dangers we do. He would have cried, wouldn't he? However men cry when they cut their hand, you know, or hit it with a with all their strength and missed the nail and hit there. You know, he would have felt that in the fullness of his humanity. It's always that that one line, is it Silent Night? Well, how's that? No crying he makes. That's not very good.
He came out solid.
Yeah.
We went to a youth justice thing once. Service, and one of the young guys, they were talking about the virgin birth. And one of the young guys pipes up, one of the Mary kids pipes up and said, did Mary scream?
Yeah. But you know what? I was a part of a theatrical production. This was several years ago, many years ago in Cleveland, and they they had written this musical about the, and the end of the story was the birth of Jesus. So it's the, it was Mary and Joseph and the whole, just the whole thing leading up to that point. And so when they portrayed the birth, they did it in this sort of montage, you know, thing. But nonetheless, they show Mary, like it's in slow motion or something. But they show Mary giving birth, you know, like she's crying, like she's in pain, like she's heaving, breathing, you know, and all that. And there was protest from some of the Catholic churches in Cleveland. Yeah, that
because
it shouldn't have been portrayed that Mary was in pain.
Because being the Lord of God came out easy.
Well, I just think it was a mistaken understanding of the hope that we have that not only Mary, but for certain that the Lord Jesus was fully human.
Yeah.
Genesis 3, when God said, in pain you shall bring bear children, he, God was thinking about the birth of his own son.
Yeah, yeah, that's right.
Good.
Yeah.
Because it'd be a pain to him and it'd be a pain to Mary.
Yeah, that's it.
Before the end of this last summer, we Logan and I, a couple of guys from church, we three trucks and cars, and we went out to the forest to cut up wood. And I didn't forget it because these guys had these big chainsaws, big motorized chainsaws, you know, zipping through the wood, and all of a sudden they both just put their chainsaws up and they're going to get the file and start sharpening the blade on the...
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, what do you need to do that for, bro? Just keep pushing the button on the chainsaw. But you know, sort of reminded me, because you know, you're looking at the sun's going down, you know, you're running out of time, but they both just take the time, 15, 20 minutes, sharpen the, you know, big long chainsaw blades, sharpen them up, big motors, and it sort of reminds me, you know, it's so true, you know.
Yeah.
And when you know what your machine can do, you know how much it can take, and you know when you've got to stop. And,
it's
full.
That's good. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And he's applying that to us as people.
Yeah, and then also it ties down on verse 18. And I've heard that preached a few times. It's always been in terms of practical thing, you know, a good man takes care of things around the house. And then I was just, the last couple of weeks I've been thinking about Proverbs 24, a pastor filled with a sluggard and was overgrown because he, you know, folded his hands. And I've always heard that preached too about not taking care of stuff in the practical world, but it hit me like, I know guys, and I'm a bit of a sluggard with getting around to doing those things, even though I can't do them.
Yeah.
But then it just hit me one day, like, but what about the guys who are really good at those things, but their marriages are falling apart?
Mm-hmm.
And their wives sometimes will say, like, they're so frustrated because they don't know how to talk to their kids. And, you know? Mm-hmm. And kind of like, they fold their hands.
Mm-hmm.
And instead of doing that, hard relational work, but doing something else to be or out in the shop fixing a car, you know.
Right.
So it's like, yeah, that really, like, wow, you know.
Yeah.
I'm not in such awe of those kind of guys now who keep everything ship shape, perhaps, because there's the other side of life. Often their relationships aren't, you know, so they're gifted there but not there, and I might be the other way.
Yeah.
So neither of us can judge the other.
Right.
But I think that's quite important.
Mm-hmm.
To not just read, because these just get read at face value, and even preached at face value. You know, they're after seeing, I've never heard it put in context of a society or a country or a family.
Yeah.
Yeah, which is actually the point.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Do you think in verse 20, the preacher is asking those who have witnessed verses 6 through
19
is saying, okay, you experienced this, but now as you think about it, even in your thoughts, don't curse him. Yes, he's a foolish ruler, but don't curse him, and here's why. So there's this, that switch from declaring the folly of leadership or errors they can fall into, but is acknowledging that the recipients of that rule will sometimes recognize those errors. It's then how do you respond to
it? Yeah, that's interesting, isn't it?
Does that make sense?
Yep. As you read down through the chapter, we could start to feel, you know, riled up, where we would say, you know, yeah, this is not right and that's not right, and yeah, I've seen those errors and all that. But by ending with that verse, which at first sounds kind of odd, he really minimizes that. He cuts across the idea that then we would just rise up, and he tells us to look at ourselves. It is a bit of a warning. You know, in this context, that if you say such a thing, there's consequences to it. The king will hear it. You know, he'll find out.
Except being wise as a serpent, kind of, isn't it?
Yeah.
Mm.
look at this section from verse 5 on, it seems like it sounds to me slightly different from some of the other stuff that he was talking about. Hey, vanity, vanity, there is some human wisdom. I've seen a lot of folly, like, you know, no matter what happens, we kind of all die. You know, it's just like, kind of like a point. Then you see this, I think verse 5 says, there's an evil that I've seen under the sun. That seems a little, is that also kind of into the realm of folly, or is it slightly? He seems like he's talking about slightly something different than folly or pointlessness. I don't know, but it's just like, because he talked about the thing, like, things that are definitely wrong. That are. Yeah, so, because it seems, I'm trying to figure a context where it looks like in this is like, you know, life under the sun again. You know, when there's folly, there's evil. I mean,
yeah. So, like,
hope that makes sense.
Yeah, absolutely. So let's, like, go back to chapter 3 for a moment. And verse 16. Well, verse 9, you know, verse 10, sorry. I have seen the business that God has given. Then verse 16, moreover, I saw under the sun that in the place of justice, even there was wickedness. Chapter 4, then, verse 1. Again, I saw all the oppressions that are done under the sun. Then chapter 5, you know, verse 1, guard your steps. And then in verse 13 of chapter 5, there's a grievous evil that I've seen under the sun, that I've seen under the sun. Riches were kept to the owner. Verse 18 of chapter 5, behold what I have seen, right, as he brings us back to Eden. Then in chapter 6, there is an evil that I have seen under the sun that lies heavy on the heart. Anyway, what he's been doing as we go along is cataloging for us the various kinds of evils that he sees under the sun and the folly that results from those evils in contrast to wisdom. So here he is in chapter 10 again. Chapter 10, now he's saying, I've seen an evil under the sun. This time, it's the error of the ruler that I'm talking about. And so it's part of this long catalog of various ways that evil expresses itself and the things that we have to bear with under the sun.
Right. That's definitely helpful. Maybe I'm trying to do something that you really can't do in this book, is kind of slowly develop the context. It's a little bit, again, a little bit difficult. I'm kind of wondering, when I hear vanity of vanities, you know, obviously it screams at you in the verse ahead, in chapter and verse 2. And I'm thinking about everything, okay, let's look at everything under this thing, under the issue of vanity, which it doesn't apply, but I almost wonder at the... Well, it's a very important concept of this, but I wonder if it's more the issue of, like, life under the sun.
Yes.
When you look at life under the sun, one thing you get, like, pretty bang, is life under the sun. There is some evil, life under the sun. You know, all the wise men does things, the foolish men does things, but they both experience pain in their life, both experience evil in their life, they both die.
Yeah.
And so, I'm just trying to get it more.
Yeah, that's it.
How they pull? Can you look in and pull back a little? Look in and pull back is like, am I making any sense at all? I'm just trying to figure this out a little bit. So.
Yeah, I think that's right. If you're looking for what is the one overarching, you know, statement about this book, it's probably best to start with life under the sun.
Because I've always had vanity as the key thing. Because it's just
right.
It's so blatantly stated, it's obvious to focus on that.
And then the first thing that he says about life under the sun is vanity. Because he isn't speaking about life above the sun. He's not addressing for us the kingdom of God.
Right. Because at one time there's life under the sun, there's life under the heavens or something of that sort in there. Mm-hmm. Oh, lightly from perspective. Because I know that it looks like him talked about life under the sun is all this pain or tough or brutal aspect of living in this world.
Yeah.
Well, it's not really looking at God in there, but he's looking at it. And I keep on thinking,
This is life in a fallen world.
Yes.
This is life. This is life because of what we've done.
Yeah.
Against God, and we have to deal with that, regardless if you believe it or not. We still live in a fallen world. But then there's God isn't. God is above this. The life is beyond life under the sun. He's not constrained by the same things we are.
Right.
I think so. Anyway.
So we should
go plus symbols off of maybe, but.
No, that's really good. You know, if you're reading a book, whatever the novel would be, Moby Dick or something, and you just open up the middle of the book and start reading some chapters, you don't really have any idea what's going on. This just makes no sense to me. What's this whale? What's happening with who is? How do you even say the name? You know. What's Ahab all upset about? What's going on? Well, and then if you thought to yourself, well, this just doesn't make sense. I'm not going to read this book, and you put it down. And someone comes along to you and says, you know, it might be helpful to start with chapter 1. Because in order to understand what's going on in this part of the novel, you got to know what came before. And that the part that you read isn't where it ends. There's a whole story that comes after that. Well, the Bible's like that. Wherever we drop in the Bible, something has preceded the story, and there's something after it, unless you're in Revelation, right? Something after. So when we come into Ecclesiastes here, we can't read it just on its own as if it's an isolated book pulled out from the Bible. We have to see it in light of the story which started in Genesis chapter 1. And everything that's gone on before that. And so, and this isn't the end of the story. You know, there's a whole lot more coming. And so that's why, you know, Old Testament scholars point out the connection between Ecclesiastes and the book of Genesis, because God created everything good, and then you see just how everything falls apart, and what people do to one another through the book of Genesis. Just all the brutalities of one another, and the kings and rulers and all that kind of stuff. And so I say all that to say, yeah, you're right on track, man. When you see it as connected, you know, to this whole story. And this is like a description of when God cursed Adam and Eve and the land. This is like a description of what happens to a cursed place, you know.
Kind of interesting analogy is there's a movie I remember, a friend of mine said, oh, you got to see this movie, it's called Memento. And Christopher Nolan, who did the Batman film, brilliant director. And the movie starts out going from the end of the story to the front, but at the same time it goes from the front of the story to the end. It goes 10 minutes here, it goes 10 minutes. And I hate when people, what's going on here? Just watch the movie, you know. But also it's kind of good, what the heck is happening here? I'm like, I'm really thrown for a loop. He goes, just watch, trust me, just watch. And so, but I had a thought, okay, this is,
right.
I'm trying to put these two, it goes, I don't see how they relate at all.
Yeah.
It's not like two different individuals, same individual.
Yeah.
But when at the very end, it was just this, ah, now I get it.
Yeah.
But I'm looking at this, I'm going, I don't disagree with any particular point, but trying to like, what's the whole thing trying to say really? So initially it's so confusing.
Yeah.
Like, things slowly making sense, but it's not one of those, like, I mean, going through Genesis, it's a linear story.
Right.
You just start going, you kind of like, oh yeah, this is kind of what's happening. Here it's just like, it's not telling stories, it's giving you this is what's happening under the sun. And it throws this, throws that, throws curveball, throws a slider.
Yeah, that's right. Know?
And it's just like, man, it's very different perspective of the human experience, of our human experience, than most of the other books.
Mm-hmm.
Just like Psalms is a very different perspective, but it's just like, I had to pull back on what's going on, what's going on, everything. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a great book, but I'm just trying to slowly, the battle to figure it out is much harder than Genesis.
Yes, and because Because we can't figure it out. Because this is poetry.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's poetry, parable, it's a proverb. And so those things invite us in to an unsolved thing that we think about, reflect on, ruminate on, walk with. Yeah.
Do you think that's because of narrative, it's very easy to distance ourselves? We can stand back and observe and just leave it, leave the story to run.
Mm.
And whether we step in or not doesn't actually affect it.
Mm.
Whereas I feel like with this book, you have to engage with it.
Yeah.
You have to go, I agree or don't. It's very hard to stay distance.
Yeah. And then we get to ask ourselves, you know, why would God give us a book like this? What does this tell us about God? God can, what does it tell you that God can communicate with poems, riddles, unanswered questions, and proverbs, and require you to engage something that you can't answer or solve? What does that tell you about God? You know, I mean, that's worth thinking about for another 3 months, you know. Because this is God's word. So, same God that inspired Paul to write Romans, same God that's giving us this language. And so, this is, when we read Ecclesiastes, I think we end up saying, ah, you know, it's kind of like you have a friend, and then that friend ends up doing something, you're like, oh, I didn't know that about you. You know, all this time, I didn't know that about you. And if we've been reading Galatians, Philippians, Colossians, you know, most of the time, and a psalm here and there, come into Ecclesiastes, we have to say, oh, I didn't know God was like this. I didn't know he talked like this. I didn't know he had language like this. I didn't know he valued this kind of speech. I didn't know he would invite us into something we can't fully solve. I didn't know that about God. Yeah. And another analogy is what's that story? Pride and Prejudice. You ever heard of this story, Pride and Prejudice? There's a Jane Austen, and there's this guy, Mr. Darcy, and all along the storyline, you think Mr. Darcy's this bad guy. He just seems like aloof and distant and kind of harsh and all that. And then you find out that actually he's a man of good character and strength, and he's actually a heroic sort of figure in light of an ongoing storyline. And in some small way, Ecclesiastes is like that. At first glance, God seems sort of, we're not sure about this character as we get to chapter 12 here, or we're not sure about the preacher and what he's trying to do. As it all unfolds and we get to the end, we realize this preacher hasn't been despairing. He's been cataloging for us why we lament in a fallen world and giving us every good reason to do it. Leaving us, finally, someone doesn't try to answer questions you can't answer. You know, there's no tried answers here. This isn't Job's friends, you know. This is, instead of like, hey, you shouldn't feel bad, he's like, man, I know it sucks. Hey, you should have more faith. He's like, man, I understand why faith is hard. And so, the fact that God is behind all that, you know, this is God. It's really, you know, a lot to ruminate on with that. Well, we come into chapter 11, just moving along here, and this is a wonderful chapter of practical multiplied proverbs again. Cast your bread upon the waters, for you will find it after many days. Give a portion to seven or even to eight, for you know not what disaster may happen on earth. That's very different than an idea that says that if a disaster happens, it's God's judgment. Certainly we understand there's a category like that in the Bible, but this reminds us that there's also disasters that happen on earth that just, it's because it's, this is the nature of the world in which we live. If the clouds are full of rain, they empty themselves on the earth. If a tree falls to the south or to the north, in the place where the tree falls, there it will lie. He who observes the wind will not sow. He who regards the clouds will not reap. What's the conclusion of these proverbs? What's the moral of the proverbs? Well, as you do not know the way the Spirit comes through the bones in the womb of a woman with child, so you do not know the work of God who makes everything. So, in the morning, sow your seed, and at evening, withhold not your hand, for you do not know which will prosper, this or that, or whether both alike will be good. Light is sweet, and it is pleasant for the eyes to see the sun. Prosperity preachers turn to this and talk about money. Contextually, I have no idea how they do that. He's not talking about money at all in chapter 11. He's explicitly talked about money elsewhere. We've seen that.
They wouldn't want to go there, though.
What's that?
They wouldn't want to go there, though.
Right, they don't want to go there. Right, that's absolutely right. Yeah. It would completely counter their message. But, you know, so if you'll hear, at least in the States, we'll hear prosperity preachers say, cast your bread upon the waters. They'll interpret that as money. For you will find it after many days. Give a portion to seven or even to eight, and then you don't hear the rest. So it's just this quote of, give your money, and it'll come back to you. Well, that's just horrific, a horrific way to use this text, you know.
What's the name of that? I mean, money's on your hat, that's what you see everywhere.
Yeah. So what is he doing? These are proverbs, these are poetic bits, right? If you drop a piece of bread on the water, what happens? You'll find it later. If you throw a message in a bottle into the sea, eventually it shows up somewhere. It's just a truism, right? These are just facts. You know, the water moves a certain way. Disasters happen on the earth. Clouds, if they're full of rain, it rains. If a tree falls, unless somebody does something to it, it stays right where it fell. This is just it's the nature of things. This is the way things go. It's as true for you who follow God as for those of you who don't. Whether you are a ruler, whether you go into the house of God, it doesn't matter. This is still the same for all of us. And so you don't know what God's going to do. So do what's in front of you. In the morning, sow your seed, and in the evening, withhold not your hand. So he's using this farming analogy. And so sometimes people, we don't know what to do next in life. Should we take this job? Should we marry this person? Should we do this or that? What's my future going to be? We don't know what the future is going to be. Do what your hand finds to do right in front of you. You don't know how God's going to bless it or not. So you step in this direction and you step in that direction, just like anybody else. And you'll see what God will do. And so I find myself as a pastor turning here often, that a person is trying to decide one way or the other, but they don't have enough information yet. There's no way to decide one way or the other. So you keep setting both ways before the Lord, and you walk in the direction of both ways, and you're waiting. You're going to be faithful in this, you're going to be faithful in this, and Lord, I'm setting this before you, and you're seeing what's gonna unfold there. So that verse 4, he who observes the wind will not sow, he who regards the clouds will not reap. So he's just said, look, if it's, you know, certain kinds of clouds tell you it's going to rain. You know, other kinds of clouds, you know it's not going to rain. You know this, so act on it. You know? So don't say to yourself, oh, I can't go out and plant my field today because it might rain. Well, you know if it's going to rain or not, and you know the effect of rain or not. The fact that it rains doesn't mean you can't do your work, you know, necessarily. There's that idea throughout the wisdom literature, usually with the sluggard or the person who's afraid. I can't go out and do my work today. There might be a lion in the street. Yeah, so just outrageous excuses that come into our mind about why. So that's what he's getting at. In the midst of all of this, doing our work like anyone else, according to the way things are, we don't know how God's going to bless it. We just set it in front of him. In the midst of all this, what a reminder, light is sweet. It's pleasant for the eyes to see the sun. In the midst of it all, God has given us a pleasure, a sweetness to be out and doing our work, and seeing the sun he's given us. So, if a person lives many years, meaning that he's walked with this reality for many years, and he's seen the sun all those, let him rejoice in them all. So here he is again, coming back to that theme of joy in the provisions of God. But let him remember that the days of darkness will be many. All that comes is vanity. So there's both sides again, disquiet and delight. When things go well, rejoice. When things are hard, reflect. Consider. Rejoice in the days you have, and the days of darkness will be many. It doesn't allow us to be Tigger or Eeyore. You know, it continues to bring these things together. Just the way the Lord Jesus did, in the world you'll have many tribulations. Take heart, I have overcome the world. What a powerful statement. The Apostle Paul, sorrowing yet rejoicing. We have this treasure in a clay jar. He tells us in verse 9, rejoice, O young man, in your youth. Let your heart cheer you in the days of your youth. Walk in the ways of your heart and the sight of your eyes. But know that for all these things, God will bring you to judgment. It's really funny that we were talking about Bob Smart earlier, because Bob quoted this to me when I was in college. I was probably 20 years old. We were at the Navigators Ministry. He was on staff with the Navs, and we were meeting at Bracken Library for our weekly time together. And I was trying to think about my future, you know, as a 20-year-old. What am I going to do? What am I going to be? You know, and all that kind of stuff. And he went to this verse. And I think it's the NIV or another translation, NASB, might say something like, do whatever your heart finds to do. You know, walk in the ways of your heart and the sight of your eyes.
NIV.
Do whatever, something like this.
Yeah.
And so he said, so, you know, Zachary, whatever, you know, you desire to do, whatever your eye sees, whatever your heart desires to do, God says, go for it. Rejoice, be glad. Go after it, pursue it. He paused, and then he said, but, remember, for all these things, God will judge you. But that's exactly, you know, that's what he says. Rejoice, young man, you know, in your youth, let your heart cheer you. Do what's in your heart. Do what your eyes see. Just remember, you'll be judged for it.
Were you laughing back then?
No, I laugh now. Back then, I was like, oh, Oh, now I just laugh. I realize, wow, you know, what a good combination.
I remember hearing a preacher on a long similar lines preaching on Paul saying basically you can do anything but by the Lord and you're doing it, you know. Yeah. He's like, you can do anything you want. He's speaking to a whole group of teenagers. Legitimately, you can do whatever you want. And everyone's like, this is my kind of preacher. Like, me, you can do anything, providing you glorify the Lord. Yeah. It's like, oh, all of a sudden I can't really do that.
That's right. That's right. Yeah. There is a freedom here. It's like the Solomon said earlier, whatever your hand finds to do, do it. Rejoice. Enjoy it. You're already approved, you know. And I know that for myself, the strength of the theology I have been taught about the sovereignty and glory of God has been rich and remarkable. A downside in it that I've made of it, or that I've seen others made of it, is we don't feel free sometimes then. It's an irony. God's in control of everything, and he's delighting to bless us. He gives us these good things to enjoy. He says, whatever your hand finds to do, go for it. But I have found I am very afraid. But what if I get it wrong? Which is so funny. I'm saying God's sovereign, but I'm worried that I'll get it wrong. It's like this parable that Jesus told of the one with the one talent and the three and the six or however many it was. Do you remember the talents, the parable of the talents? And the one person doesn't, the others, you know, invest their talents and they get a return. And the one person buries it and doesn't. Do you remember why? You know, in Jesus' story, do you remember the dialogue, the reason? He's afraid because he knew something about the master. Do you remember what it was? He is a hard man.
Fear to move.
Yeah, a fear to live. Which is so strange for a person with a robust theology of the sovereignty of God. Why joy would be so hard? Or why there'd be so much fear?
It's true when you hear it, but you can overemphasize that, you know, my heart is exceedingly wicked from Jeremiah, that, you know, and it's like, but I kind of, that's a really dangerous verse to what we do with that, because, you know, if you are saved and Holy Spirit's in your heart, is my heart always wicked? Yeah. You know? No, it can't be.
Yeah.
Like it's, and he's written me a new heart. He's given me a heart of flesh, not stone.
Yeah.
And as a kid, you know, coming to the Lord at a young age, then what desires were put in me by God and what were foolish desires?
Yeah.
And I've found that over the years, you know, I didn't follow some of my childhood ones. I sort of gave them up. But then later on, God has brought me back to that. He brought those things that come to pass in ways that I didn't even aim for them, but those dreams have actually been fulfilled. And it's like, wow,
yeah.
God's showing me that those were of him,
yeah.
Because he's brought them about in ways that I didn't aim for them or whatever, and yet that I've enjoyed that, you know. And it's, well, there are things in our heart that God puts there.
Yeah.
So it's not all exceedingly. We have to be very careful we're not deceived. But
yeah.
So there's that balance, and this is the one side of it.
Yeah.
And then Jeremiah is the other.
Yeah.
But then he's a prophet, like you said, you know, word.
Yeah.
And this guy's got a bit of a different angle.
Well, and, you know, if we think of it, Solomon has been really clear about the madness in our heart. You know, we've sought out many schemes. There's folly and madness in our hearts, he said. And, you know, he's listed all these things that people do to one another with the power that they have, you know. And so all the good things can get twisted and misused and all that stuff. So he seems really robustly aware of evil in our heart and evil in the world. And yet, to your point, he continues to call us back to joy and the enjoyment of the things God's given us, and to to enjoy the pleasantness of the sun, you know, and that we don't know what our work's going to turn out to be. God does, so we just do our work, you know, and we and it's sort of trying to remove this big worry, this big anxiety about the future that looms over us. Am I going to die? Yes, you are. Are things hard in this life? Yes, the days of darkness will be many. Can I make plans and then those dreams get shattered? Yes. You could be like a bird caught up in a net all of a sudden. So how do you live, you know, because in the midst of this, God is active. In the midst of this, all his good gifts of his creation are for you. In the midst of this, you've been given a place and a people and a thing to do and good food and drink. And so it's this real, he holds it all together, you know. Both sides of that, he really holds it up like that. Remove vexation from your heart. That's remarkable for a guy who's telling us all the vexations. Put away pain from your body, for youth and the dawn of life are vanity. He's just saying, hey, while you're young, and those of us who are older, we get this more and more. While you're young, enjoy it. Not the same way that probably a culture addicted to adolescence tells us, you know. You're still young. Eat, drink, and be merry in all the other kinds of ways, right? But, hey, your youth passes. And so, while you're young, be young. And he continues on. This chapter break really can give us the idea of a new thought is happening. But really, he continues on. Remember your Creator in the days of your youth, before the evil days come and the years draw near, of which you will say, I have no pleasure in them. We were talking about this earlier. As we get older, it's harder to find pleasure sometimes. In certain things, because we've seen the fads come and go. We've given ourselves to promises that turned out to be empty. We've been prodigals who went out and had the men and the women and had the money, had the wine, had the whatever, and it. Now we see the emptiness of it. We now know that sex, laughter, art, music, work, affirmation, nature, are watermelons, but we can't use them to play football, and so they can't satisfy us. And so there is a kind of pleasure that we lose. Wisdom brings vexation and sorrow. We don't trust the emptiness of something as we get older the way we once did. So sometimes in pastoral ministry, as an example, when I speak with veteran pastors and they speak to me, a lot of us will say something like this. I don't feel the same highs and lows I did when I was a younger pastor. I don't feel the same romantic motivation of a sermon that I once did when I geared up for every sermon like it was something. And now I know that I will preach hundreds of sermons, or I have. And I'll preach more faithfully until God comes, you know, and takes me home. And if you've spoken at enough conferences or classes, as a young man, you might think to yourself, if I could only do that. Go ahead, go for it. I'll trade you any day. If you've done it enough, you realize, you know, when the tree falls, it lies there. When the clouds have rain in them, it empties it. People are people. And so what happens is veteran pastors talk more like it's faithfulness. It feels like faith. It feels like faithfulness. It feels like perseverance. It feels like endurance. It feels like trying to be a steward rather than a romantic journey. And so some of us get troubled by that at times because we think, have I lost something? Have I lost my first love or something, and we remind ourselves, no, I mean, certainly that can happen, but the fact is, it's probably we're a lot wiser than we once were. And the work that we're doing is it's hard work. And the days of darkness are many. And even if we preach the best sermon we've ever known, the next day we have to get up and go to work again. And the way I've tried to say it sometimes, and it's too crass probably, but even if the Lord grants us revival and awakening, which I would pray He would, we still have to go to the bathroom at some point. And so it's not that there isn't sweetness in the preaching. Wow, there is in ways that can be really quite surprising and remarkable. It's just that I don't have illusions anymore as we get older. Someone say there's a person who's sick in our congregation, say. They have a long-term disease or illness. I preach the best sermon I could ever muster. They still go home in their wheelchair. A husband and wife, their marriage is on the rocks. We don't know if they're going to make it. They're there in the sermon. I preach the best sermon I could ever have. They still go home to the tension. Because most occasions, the thing isn't solved in a moment. And so, when we're young, we find a pleasure in things that's really wonderful. But as we grow in wisdom, we realize some of the pleasures we found were misguided or off, and we begin to long more and more for the true treasure. Even preaching itself isn't the true treasure. Even whatever our calling is, whatever we get to our hand to do, we begin more and more to long for the Lord Himself. And so there's this sense in which chapter 12 there's a time that can come when we say, I have no pleasure in these days. Before the sun and the light and the moon and the stars are darkened and the clouds return after the rain, in the day when the keepers of the house tremble and the strong men are bent and the grinders cease because they are few, and those who look through the windows are dimmed, and the doors on the street are shut, when the sound of the grinding is low, and one rises up at the sound of a bird, and all the daughters of song are brought low. They are afraid also of what is high, and terrors are in the way. The almond tree blossoms, the grasshopper drags itself along, and desire fails, because man is going to his eternal home, and the mourners go about the streets. Before the silver cord is snapped, or the golden bowl is broken, or the pitcher is shattered at the fountain, or the wheel broken at the cistern, and the dust returns to the earth as it was, and the spirit returns to God who gave it. Vanity of vanity, says the preacher, all is vanity. He just gave us a long poem, and we feel like we don't understand all those metaphors. Poetry's like that. You're meant to linger with the metaphor and work it out. Poetry requires meditation. But what he's describing is the day of our death. So he's saying, when you're young, remember your Creator, rejoice. There are days are come when you will say, I have no pleasure in them, and the day of your funeral arrives, and your spirit goes back to be with God. So if we take all that as one, started off with cast your bread on the waters, because you don't know what God will do. It's this picture of life, doing what's in front of us, rejoicing, enjoying the light of the sun, uncertain of what our future will be, what God will do. In that light, rejoice in what your hand finds to do. When you're young, enjoy it. Remember your Creator, because the day will come when it's a time to go home to be with God. He has this full capacity for emotion, doesn't he? He's a real... he's able to hold joy and sorrow together. He's able to speak of the beauty of youth and the day of death all together, and has a capacity for the sweetness of the one and the sadness of the other. What does that tell you about God? God's heart, who God is.
I think it tells me that, boy, God loves me enough to still get cleansed of Him, mm-hmm. but He also loves me enough to see the folly of my sin.
Mm-hmm.
And this whole thing about, I try to look at, okay, like here's God's promise, here's His commandment, this is what we do, okay, kind of, to make sense of it, which is totally fine.
Yeah.
But in reality, I was thinking, life was like a tri-tip. And if I had a tri-tip, it was amazing. I've never had anything. So this was like second to me. I talked to my dad, it's very well read. He goes, it's a great piece of meat, without a doubt, but you can't eat it a whole lot because it's so high in cholesterol. And the reason being is that you take a T-bone and you cook it, you leave the fat on to give it flavor, but then you don't eat the fat, you cut it off. In tri-tip, if you look at it real closely, the fat and the meat are like this. You should kind of trend, but you can't separate what gives it the flavor is the fat. And when I look at my life, it's just pain and sorrow. It's like, joy and pain goes. Not like joy is always over here without any pain.
Mm-hmm.
Versus there's. Yeah. You can't separate your mind from your emotions. Really, you really can't. Where does one end, one begin?
Yeah.
But so, this is to me is. This is life.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And He's still there, but He's still there, but. I am living life under the sun.
Yeah.
You know, and this is going to be, I experience Him, but I'll experience what it's like to live because we are in a fallen world, and I'm a fallen person, even though I'm saved.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
I think what it tells me about God is that He rejoices in the exuberance of youth, and He rejoices in the faithfulness of old age.
Mm-hmm.
But whether it's youth or old age, it's still meaningless. And so while the youth has their exuberance and the older person has their faithfulness, at the end of the day, all any of us have is our relationship with God.
Mm-hmm.
Anything else that we have in there is ultimately meaningless.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's our relationship with Him. And, you know, I was reflecting the other day, I was visiting a man who was an old man.
Mm-hmm.
He's been a preacher all his life and he's very close to death. And I was debating whether I should, in the course of talking with him and reading the scriptures and praying with him, whether I should ask him if he is trusting Christ to cover his sin.
Mm-hmm.
I thought, well, he's my father in the faith.
Yeah.
You know, why would I? He might take it the wrong way, it might be superfluous. But anyway, I took a deep breath and asked him that anyway. Eyes lit up, and he was just so delighted to be able to affirm that at the end of his life.
Mm.
That's all we have, really.
Yeah.
Mm. When it's all over, that's all we have.
Yeah.
Mm. Well, that, to me, I guess we can learn about God too from youth, or that God, despite knowing all the bad stuff and that, He's not jaded by.
Yeah.
Like you said, He might still enjoy making every daisy and every sunset. You know, He doesn't get tired of the meaninglessness and stuff.
Yeah.
And so I think it's important for us, especially if we're in leadership, is that we do mix with young people and old people and try and get them mixing together. because otherwise they miss out. Like, you get all the young people together, there's a lot of foolishness. There might be a lot of energy and, you know, let's go do this for God, but, you know, they'll do some dumb things.
Mm-hmm.
So having some wise heads. But then older people also, you know, they catch something again from the youth about life that's infectious.
Yeah.
I've seen that with my kids, you know,
church
events, you know, just hitting a, the first time Zeke got to hit a softball around the floor with this plastic hockey stick, and he was doing it for 2 hours, and the, you know, half the church was just cracking up. It was just unbelievable, because, you know, we're past that now, and, like, you know, you give a few bats, but it was just amazing. And then he got a couple of the older guys up, you know, having stick fights, and, like, when do they get to do that?
Yeah.
And this kid, people say, oh, tone him down, he's going to put one of their eyes out, you know? It's like, they know that, like, you know, they can, it was just a neat interaction to see. We need that, you know?
Yeah.
We really need each other.
Yeah.
So sort of running church in a way where we get that mixing up.
Yeah.
I think it's really crucial.
Yeah.
And society is missing out on a lot of that. Mm-hmm. They really separate youth and old people out, sort of. So I think the church can be a great witness that draws people in just for that fact that we do have something.
Yeah.
I think... Yeah, it's a really poetical way of dying.
Mm-hmm.
It's really a nice fading out of the world.
Yes.
Not an abruptness of death.
Isn't that beautiful? Yeah.
And so this is how the book ends. It fades us out, and you think, man, this is a nice way to go.
Yeah.
Just while you fade away from your life after all this vexation.
Yeah.
So it can only come from the hand of a thoughtful poet. Someone who has who wants to take us out nicely, you know?
Yes.
Wants to end it, so.
Yeah, he forces us, like, if it's just prose, he's and he died.
Mm-hmm.
But as a poet, we all have to slow down now and linger with this day of death, you know, like, and it's really quite beautiful. He makes it beautiful.
I just thought now, I never really thought of it as losing all these capabilities is actually a mercy, because if we were strong all the way through and then dead, we wouldn't be invited to reflect. But because, you know, your teeth fall out, you get them, you start to realize that this life, you know, it comes to a close.
Yeah.
So it is a mercy.
Yeah.
These things. Maybe it's not, you know, it's not always harmful, you know, to get sick, and that gives us perspective that what's really important.
Well, we come to the end now, and it shifts from first person language, you know, to a third person description. So up to this point, he's been saying, I the preacher, I think this, I think that, I feel this. And now it says, besides being wise, the preacher also taught the people knowledge. So it sounds like the movie ended and the person died. And then there's a paragraph that comes up on the screen, and it tells you, someone else is telling you what happened. You know, it's because of that some scholars have felt that maybe the book as a whole isn't Solomon himself, but someone speaking in Solomon's voice. A modified version of that is that this last section here has been inserted, you know, after Solomon's death, to describe, you know, it. There's also the view that this is Solomon himself. Still, there's a rhetorical way that a person writing can put themselves in the third person. The Apostle Paul did that. I know a man, the Apostle Paul said, he went up into the third heaven, and, you know, this whole thing. And so those are the three basic views of what's going on here. There are others, but they're trying to account for the shift in language here. I don't have any trouble believing that Solomon could write this in this way. Artistically, death, we've just faded into death. and gone back to be with God. And so to come at it and sort of speak from a distance now can make sense artistically as a person writing poetry, proverb. But the point of it is how it goes here. Besides being wise, another way to say it, besides being wise, the preacher also taught the people knowledge, weighing and studying and arranging many proverbs with great care. The preacher sought to find words of delight, and uprightly he wrote words of truth. The words of the wise are like goads and like nails, firmly fixed are the collected sayings. They are given by one shepherd. My son, be aware of anything beyond these. I'm making many books, there is no end, and much study is a weariness of the flesh. The end of the matter, all has been heard. Fear God, keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God will bring every deed into judgment with every secret thing, whether good or evil. So we wade through an inductive process all the way through, and he finally says, the end of the matter is this, everything's been heard. What do we conclude? Fear God. So this is what the wise say. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So this is classic wisdom literature expression. This is fear God. What that means for the wise is that God is the source and governor of all everything real. So I start from that vantage point. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. I start from the vantage point that God is God, and everything that I encounter is created and governed, authored by him, overseen by him. I fear him. I recognize that. I bow before that truth. And I keep his commandments. And this is my whole duty. I revere and honor him, and I follow him. This is my purpose in life. And we can feel, if we've come from a kind of background that has preachers yelling fire and brimstone at us, we can be really troubled by how this book ends. Someone who's been really hurt and damaged by church people could really have a hard time here because of the way they would hear it. So I want to remind us of a couple of things about judgment here at the end. You know, God will judge you. That's how it ends, right? Number one, just notice there's no screaming or yelling here. There's no exclamation points. There's no red-faced intensity. It's very calmly stated. And it's intended to be good news. We finally heard all of this. We've faded off. We've passed out and gone, you know, we've passed out from it all and gone back to God who gave it. What's the purpose of it all? That we would follow the Lord. Know him, follow him. This is my whole purpose. I will be judged by him. Not just me, but everything. It's very calm. Calmly stated. There's no pointing fingers. Secondly, notice the good news of it. Why is judgment good news? If you read this in the context of everything that's preceded it, why is judgment good news?
It'll make sense of everything that you couldn't make sense of.
Yeah.
So yeah. It isn't finally vanity. Now it is, but
yeah. So when we've heard preachers yell fire and brimstone hell at us, even though Jesus, when he speaks about hell, doesn't do it that way, what happens is we picture God's judgment as some kind of, God is this raging, rageaholic, bloodthirsty to judge. And when you stand before him, he'll rip you to shreds because he loves to do so, you know. Some fleshly description of anger and attributing it to God. There's no sin in God. His wrath isn't rage. It's not the tirade of a coach on the side of a field. It's not an abusive dad, you know. Judgment, if at its best, what's our experience of it? You go to a court of law, there's a judge sitting there. If he's a good, or she is a good and fair judge of integrity, they look you in the eye, they listen, they're calm, firm, they won't take a bribe, you know, and they see through our manipulations, and they're seeking to render fair judgment. And why do they seek to do that? Because when judgment is given fairly and rightly, the victim is defended. This is why judgment is good news and why we all long for it. The victim is defended. It isn't just that the perpetrator is found out. It's that the one who's been abused, the one who's been burgled, the one who's been assaulted, the one who's been murdered in their family, you know, they're defended, and what was true and right is upheld. And so judgment is good news here, because all of this sinned against stuff that he's talked about, all these evils under the sun, all these moments where the wise and the good were mistreated and lost out, and the wicked made their lives go longer with more wickedness, all of that will come to an end. And those, the victims will be defended. Perpetrators will be judged. Now that's good news. It's very, very good news. That's why it's hard to watch a movie like No Country for Old Men. If you've ever seen this movie or read the story, I don't recommend watching it if you have a tender conscience like mine. That's the kind of movie I could only watch once in life. And I probably should have just read a summary. An evil serial killer. You watch him kill people all through the movie, and then he gets away. And that's how it ends. And when you watch that, I'm thankful for an author who can write like that, because he writes in such a way, and the movie thankfully portrays it in such a way, that you're left thinking to yourself, this isn't right. You know, I mean, really? And it evokes the longing that that person would be judged. And not just because we are afraid and want that kind of evil stop, but this whole list of people, he just kills, would be somehow defended, you know. So it's good news. At the end of this book, all of these evils under the sun will be set right. And it's good news because every secret thing, whether good or evil. So it's not just those who have been sinned against will be vindicated, defended. It's that those who did what was right will be upheld. Finally. And then the bad news is that all of us have been both the sinner and the sinned against. All of us have been both mixtures of good and evil in what we've done. All of us have had to say we're sorry for things. So Jesus says this, right? I mean, doesn't it sound like the Lord Jesus when he talks about judgment, that every secret thing will be found out and will come into the light? Doesn't it sound like the Apostle Paul as he speaks about when we stand before the Lord and everything will be brought into judgment, and the good news of it, and the soberingness of it. And so that's where he ends. Love God, follow him, everything will be made right, set right, judged by God. And that means that none of these evils or oppressions will have the last word. The last sentence of the book tells us that God will have the last word. Every evil thing that was done, God will have the last word. As an illustration, you know, we have a zombie narrative in the United States. I don't know if it's like that here. Just all kinds of movies and TV shows about zombies and books. They just keep coming, you know. It'll end eventually. But the zombie fad where, you know, you're just constantly chased by death and you can never escape it. And no matter how much you kill it, it keeps coming after you, right? And the narrative of the gospel says that goodness and mercy are pursuing you all the days of your life. It's not, death will die. And so the zombie narratives are helpful because it tells us we're pursued by death and evil. But it's empty. It's wrongheaded in its conclusion, and if it's making a conclusion. It's just a genre of story, right? But the genre of story, there's no redemption. You can never escape it. Even when you get the farthest out away and you're sitting by the beach and you think you're with your child and everything's fine, somehow a zombie pops up through the sand, you know, and grabs your leg. Like you can never escape it. And the goodness, the truth of that is we can't escape death and we can't escape evil. But the good news of God and Jesus Christ is that the story doesn't end there, that God will judge every secret thing, whether good or evil, and we will soon find out that when we stand before the Lord, that surely goodness and mercy had followed us all the days of our life. That no one could have snatched us out of Jesus' hand, and that nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ. And so that feisty declaration, you know, is what Solomon's making here. God will have the last word. So in our last 5 minutes here, let's just respond. I don't know, reflect, you know. Logan, you got saying you have something, or are you just stretching?
What?
Yeah.
I'm just struck with an incredible sense of awe and just how big God is. And, you know, it can be so easy to categorize God. You know, when we're thinking theology, we categorize him into all these little boxes. Mm-hmm. And then you read a book like this, and you hear God talking in this way.
Mm-hmm.
You know, God looking at the state of the world.
Yeah.
God reflecting on these things and sharing his feelings and thoughts.
Yeah.
And I guess I just come to the stark realization that God is infinitely bigger than I ever imagined. And coming to terms with that is just beyond my comprehension.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Amen.
If that last section of verses just 9 to 13, if that wasn't there, I would have just said without a doubt, why is this book here? It's absolutely pointless. It doesn't go anywhere. Mm-hmm. So, but at the same time, I'm glad it's here, but I just like, why didn't you go a whole chapter on this? I mean, you know, do what Paul does, you know, in his
mm-hmm.
sleep.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing I really find comfort in this is that it seems like, say, life in the sun, pain. We all, good or bad, you die. And that's mm-hmm. the way it is. But it says, but get out from under the sun, under God and his judgment. Life really isn't pain.
Mm-hmm.
But we have to get out from under the sun and look at and kind of start thinking about it. And what you're seeing about as you get older, you seem to enjoy life, the highs and lows. It's,
mm-hmm.
I find that very true. And but the thing that it tells me is that the highs and low, I think, are very specific relative to life on earth.
Mm-hmm.
And how, like, you know, I really love something terribly, strongly, that is temporary.
Yeah.
And that nihilism of that, of just like, well, this is, it's fun, it's great, but it's temporary. You've done thing, you know, 15 times. You might have been a religious experience the first time. Yeah, it was fun. It was nice, but and it's, I'm slowly seeing the need, or slowly shifting to seeing that, man, it's temporal. This is really temporal, and God's word is beyond temporal. It's the fourth dimension, if you will. And if it wasn't for having God's word, I would say somebody would ever get you tonight. Mm-hmm. I mean, drug, sex, rock and roll, whatever gets you tonight.
Right.
And I would have blew my brains out.
Mm-hmm.
I don't. Life is too painful without a point.
Mm-hmm.
And anyway.
Yes, that's well said.
This conclusion makes me want to reread the book of Ecclesiastes in the light of this conclusion, mm-hmm. because in fact this conclusion has been on every page.
Yes.
It's been there all along, mm-hmm. and you don't see it till you get to the end. And
yeah.
You realize life under the sun is all about teaching us this conclusion. You have to wait till you die to come to this realization.
Mm-hmm.
And then you extend that out towards the rest of the scriptures. It's there on every page of the whole Bible.
Yeah.
And the conclusion is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And you go back and read it again, the light of Jesus.
Yeah. And it's like we've seen him gradually unfolding it. Like he begins to talk about God more explicitly in chapter 3. And then he, you know, brings that back down. And I think by chapter 8, it's more full. And then by the time you get here, you realize, yeah, this is the point he's been making all along. He just didn't see it.
The quick conclusion of the whole book has to bring us back to the conclusion that there is life after death.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's just it.
Amen. Yeah. Yeah, you know, verse 7, dust returns to dust, you know, spirit returns to God who gave it. That's this picture of going home to the one we were made for.
Just reflecting on verse 14, you know, for God will bring every deed into judgment with every secret thing, whether good or evil. And, you know, read that in light of Christ, and then read it if there is no Christ,
mm-hmm.
and it's either a verse of despair
mm-hmm.
or a verse of rejoicing.
Mm-hmm.
Because if there's no Christ, that's the scariest thing we can ever read.
Yes.
Because we will die, and then we have that picture of God as
yes.
the wrathful judge. Because
yes.
wow, I have to answer for everything.
Wow.
But with Christ, we don't have that. We have
yeah.
a fair judge.
Yes, there's a it's helpful, you know, to remember that this preacher is the son of David. It just puts it in there's a long storyline here. Regarding the promise made to David and his heirs. And the son of David speaking here. And the son of David will come.
It just reminds me that our God is so great, you know. When I sort of reflect to our youth, and now we get to he is dead. You know, from there, as you go through life,
mm-hmm.
you know, life under the sun,
mm-hmm.
and you, as you come to know the Lord, and all this youth things that you've done, you know, like I said, oh, you know, I wish.
Mm-hmm.
But then as you grow halfway, like You're over 50, uh-huh. You're over 60.
Yeah.
You reflect on all these things that he's talking about.
Yeah.
And it makes oneself cringe
mm-hmm.
because how the Lord is so merciful.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I wouldn't be sitting here today and reflecting on the merciful of God. And come to the last, it's always been my favorite. Yes, the whole purpose of my life. You know?
Yeah.
Is to serve Him.
Yeah.
And it's just so much serving it. It's knowing
mm-hmm.
who He is. Every time when we hear that you're gonna do a study on this book, I was so excited because I wanted to know what this is all about, but I couldn't wait to get to the last verse. Do you know what I mean?
Yes.
You know, you contain all those things, the wisdom of God, the love of God.
Yeah.
And then here it is, right there.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
I get emotional because
it's lovely.
I love Him.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
We'd be nothing, really.
Yeah.
If we don't know who He is and He, you know. I'm always grateful when He did. I know. I didn't go after Him.
Mm-hmm.
It's special when He takes you. Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah.
And it's really cool.
Amen.
And it's true. Life after me mm-hmm. is great.
Yeah.
You know. Funny how people say to you, I die and that's it. I said, no, you die and life begins.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
And then of course you share what I mean by that.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah. So thank you. This is my opportunity to say thank you, Zach.
Oh, thank you
for coming and
yeah.
just, yes, it's cool.
It's a very kind, I'm thankful to be here and it's a joy to be with you, you know, and to spend our days like this. And I was thinking about, I was thankful that God gave us an artist king, a poet king, to write this book because, By waiting to get here to this last verse, it causes us to appreciate it so much more. Like, finally, we get to hear this, you know, which is really like life, you know, wading through all the stuff of life and finally. And the poet is able to write it like that, to delay, to delay, to delay, to delay, and then, you know, and that long poem at the end, you know. Yeah, thanks be to God. Well, we're at our time, and so why don't I give thanks to the Lord. Lord, we give thanks to You, for You are good. Your mercies endure forever. Your steadfast love doesn't quit. We want to thank You. You are lovely to behold. Thanks for saving us. Thanks for creating us. Thanks for delighting in Your creative work in us. Thank You for our future and a hope. Thank You for judgment. Thank You for a Savior. Thank You for new life. Thank You for Solomon, for redeeming him and all the wreckage of his life. Thanks for the hope that that holds out for us in Christ. We thank You that You've said the days of darkness will be many. But we thank you too that you've said there is joy and there's life beyond the grave. And we thank you in Jesus' name, amen.